pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mr. Krasny, would you please call the roll?
Yes, Mr. Amidits?
Here.
Mrs. Buckley?
Here.
Mr. Christensen?
Here.
Mrs. Cook?
Here.
Mrs. Dobus?
Here.
Mr. Means?
Here.
Mr. Nagel?
Here.
Mrs. Rule?
Here.
Mr. Workmeister?
Here.
Nine members present.
Thank you. For our first presentation this evening, it is my pleasure to welcome Allegheny County Councilwoman Sue Means back to the community room for a special recognition of a group of high school students who recently brought positive recognition to Bethel Park on a national level. Councilwoman Means, the podium is yours.
Oh, thank you. Are the students here?
Yes.
Are there teachers here?
Yes.
Come on. Well, it's my honor to be here again, and this is exciting because this is an academic recognition. So I'm going to go ahead and read the proclamation that pretty much explains everything. From the Office of Allegheny County Council, a proclamation recognizing the winners of the Police Data Challenge. Whereas three Bethel Park high school students, Alina Cicero, Sean Conroy, and Elise Bermudez, is that right?
Bermudez.
Participated in a high school elective called the Big Data Analytics that was taught by science teacher Lee Cristofano and marketing teacher Emily Smoyer. Boy, I blew that one. Under their direction, the three Bethel Park students were named in the Police Data Challenge, a competition involving 20 high schools nationwide. Whereas the three Bethel Park High School students won the Police Data Challenge, a competition that requires students to use data available through the Police Data Initiative in order to analyze, complex data sets from Baltimore, Cincinnati, Seattle police departments and recommend innovative solutions to enhance public safety. Whereas the Bethel Park High School students analyzed data they received from the Baltimore Police Department and used that material to figure out the crime patterns in the Baltimore region. Through data analysis, the students focused on a variety of aspects, including the top 10 common crimes, the times of day the crimes were committed, and the times of year the crime was most prevalent, and the frequency of specific crimes. And whereas in December 2017, the three Bethel Park students, high school students, won first place in the best use of external data category. Now, therefore, be it resolved that I, Allegheny County Council member Sue Means, does hereby congratulate the Bethel Park High School student team for winning the Police Data Challenge, and we recognize the team for their contributions and achievements that will inspire our youth to dedicate themselves to a better future. Thank you very much.
Congratulations. If you take a look at the agenda for tonight's meeting, you will see the board will be accepting a generous donation from the Bethel Park Soccer Association. The BPSA has purchased and donated a set of 8x24-foot soccer goals for the Bethel Park High School practice turf fields, as well as a set of 6.5x18.5-foot soccer goals for the Bethel Park High School practice fields. The combined value of these nets is $9,080. We are honored to accept this generous donation that will benefit our students for years to come, and we thank the BPSA for their continued partnership with the school district to provide valuable support to our student athletes. At this time, I would like to invite BPSA President Eric Lancey and past president and current registrar Scott DiGiorno to join me at the podium so that I can present a certificate of appreciation on behalf of the Bethel Park School District. I want you gentlemen to share this certificate with your membership and tell them how much we appreciate their continued partnership. It is cooperative efforts like this that help to make the Bethel Park School District the great place that it is. And we thank you again for this generous donation. Please, a round of applause. Gentlemen, join me. Are there any additions or corrections to the agenda?
Yes, I have a few. On page 3, under the approval of extra duty responsibility program for cheerleader, I would like to list Jillian Lindberg. On page 4, for cheerleading assistant would be Andarina Radonsky. And on page 11, under other, I would like to insert Pam Dobis under the vote for trustee of the Southeastern region for the Allegheny County School Health Insurance Consortium for a 2-year period effective April 30th, 2018. And I would like to add an 5th item for a resolution opposing ESA voucher program SB2.
Anything else?
That's it.
I need a motion to adopt the agenda with these additions.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That carries 9-0. I need a motion to approve the minutes of the business meeting of February 20th, 2018 and the regular meeting of February 27th, 2018.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That carries 9-0. I need to announce executive sessions held March 7th, 2018 for personnel, other legal matters, and to receive information. March 20th, 2018 for personnel, other legal matters, and to receive information. And March 27th, 2018 for personnel, other legal matters, and to receive information. Staff report, and Mrs. Sutton.
We are pleased to present the following good news items to you this evening. Bethel Park High School mock trial team concluded its most successful season to date, advancing to the finals of the Allegheny County mock trial competition, finishing their season one victory away from competing in the state mock trial competition. Congratulations to Madison Newman, Elizabeth Hartnett, Christian McLean, Mara Nicoli, Edric Craven, Graydon Tomkowitz, Caleb Shook, John Veltum, Isabella Kansias, and Blake Melchert. They were coached by Bethel Park High School teacher Christine Robb and local attorneys Kenneth Hager and Bridget Smith. Congratulations to the students on a great season. Our Bethel Park High School forensic students are also winding down a successful season, competing at several local competitions and qualifying for state and national tournaments. Participating at the state championships at Bloomsburg University, which were held this month, were Graydon Tomkowitz, Jillian Sullivan, Caleb Shook, Hannah Gold, and Tanush Ball. At states, Tanush advanced to the finals in Congress, and Graydon and Jillian advanced to the quarterfinals in news broadcasting. Qualifications for the National Catholic Forensic League Grand Tournament, which will be held in Washington, D.C. during Memorial Day weekend, are Madison Newman and Caleb Shook. Caleb also qualified for the National Speech and Debate Association's National Tournament in June in Fort Lauderdale as a second alternate in the Congress event. Congratulations to all our qualifiers, and good luck to Madison and Caleb at Nationals. Bethel Park High School German students did very well at the Three Rivers Day German Day competition, earning 2 first place, 3 second place, and 1 third place awards. Congratulations to Evan Ehrenhalt, Abby Cannon, Brandon Janis, Noah Voskamp, Rachel Nijinsky, and Emily Clairvitt for doing a great job at this competition, which celebrates German history, culture, and the arts. 9 Bethel Park High School students had the opportunity to participate with students from Upper St. Clair High School to develop solutions to 3 issues posed to them by the EA Fab Corporation and present their findings to the company's owners and members of their management team at California University of Pennsylvania's South Point campus. The Bethel Park participants were students in the computer integrated manufacturing class at the high school, taught by Mr. Shisutsky. The class has the students solving real-world problems using human-centered design techniques, as well as more traditional problem-solving methods. For the second year, Bethel Park students worked with the EA Fab, a Pittsburgh-based company that designs and fabricates equipment and parts for steel mills throughout North America. Throughout this partnership, the students were given the opportunity to apply newly learned problem-solving methods and their own unique strengths to solve real-world challenges. The problems posed to them by the EA Fab were varied in scope and required the students to explore new subject areas that they might not otherwise have the opportunity to learn about. Doing a great job presenting their ideas were Evan Ehrenhalt, Darian Dzinski, Victoria Slowinski, Devin Gaynor, Alex Kokevich, Jacob Logan, Mark Curie, Sean Puskar, and Ryan Titchler. Bethel Park High School and Independence Middle School students earned 1 gold medal, 5 silver medals, and 3 bronze medals at the Family Career and Community Leaders of America's state competition. Congratulations to Bethel Park High School students, Kelly Catilius, Alyssa Vatier, Caitlin Chickwalk, Jessica Toogood, Michaela Narr, Michaela Carter, and Kayla Richards, as well as Independence Middle School students, Elijah Carter, Shia Epperson, Anaya Hunter, Mia Gunther, Anne-Marie Lorenzi, Ella Hubner, and Ella Morgan for doing a great job. Kelly, Anaya, Shia, and Anaya qualified to compete at the FCCLA National Competition, which will be held in July. Bethel Park High School and Independence Middle School students competed at the recent Science Olympiad, bringing home 1 first place, 1 third place, and 3 fourth place awards. Congratulations to Bethel Park High School students Sarah Gilliam, Sarah Long, Grace Evans, Jordan Mahalko, Todd Ackerman, and Max McKittrick, as well as Independence Middle School students Toyosi Egbebi and Allie Scarlett. Bethel Park High School and Independence Middle School students also competed at the 27th Annual Southwestern Pennsylvania Science Bowl competition. The high school team, Evan Ehrenhalt, Todd Ackerman, Kayla Armstrong, Max McKittrick, and Jerry Varghese, finished in a tie for second place in their division, while the Independence Middle School team, Allie Scarlett, Toyosi Igbebi, Alex Markunis, Aleko Fekos, and Demetrios Fekos, won 4 out of the 6 rounds in their division. Four Bethel Park High School students received the extra effort for the third quarter of the 2017-18 school year from the Steele Center for Career and Technical Education. Congratulations to Abigail Berry, Menzi Atkoff, Riley Sullivan, and Nathan Askins. To receive this award, students must demonstrate outstanding attitude, work ethic, attendance, and dependability. Congratulations to these students, and keep up the good work. Bethel Park High School students Sabrina Titalius and Alyssa George did a great job representing their school at the SHASDA Student Forum, which was held at Upper St. Clair High School. SHASDA is an acronym for South Hills Area School Districts Association, and the organization represents 23 school districts in the southern part of Allegheny County and the northern part of Washington County. Sabrina and Alyssa shared their big data class and competition projects with the event's attendees. Thanks to Sabrina and Alyssa for representing Bethel Park High School so well. 11, Bethel Park High School vocalists successfully auditioned and were selected to sing in the Pennsylvania Music Educator Association's All-State Chorus, which will be held in April in Lancaster. Congratulations to Natalia and Kowiak, William Brzoski, Kayla Dell, Garrett Hoffman, Molly Hoffman, Michaela Eisenberg, Anthony Lucidi, Jeff McCain, Brian Pauly, Tyler Petrosi, and Cameron Silman. Congratulations to Bethel Park High School senior Connor Remington, who successfully auditioned and will play the tuba in the Pennsylvania Music Educator Association's All-State Band, which will also be held in April in Lancaster. Our sports teams recently concluded a successful winter sports season. Our varsity competitive cheerleaders won the Whippeal Championship and finished in second place at the state championships, third place at the national championships, and fourth place at the international championships. Our girls basketball team advanced to the Whippeal semifinals and the state quarterfinals. Indoor track athlete James Crandall earned a silver medal at the state indoor track championships and competed at the national championships. At the TSTCA indoor track championships, 14 athletes earned 9 medals. Natalie Myers finished in third place at the Whippeal Rifle Championships, and Erin Rutherford finished in 12th place. Both girls competed at the state rifle championships. In wrestling, Jason Montgomery won the section championship, finished in third place at the Whippeal Championships, and competed in the state championships. At the Whippeal Championships, he was joined by 7 teammates who finished fifth place or higher at the section championships. Candace Chalice finished in 8th place at the Whippeal Swimming Championships. At the Whippeal Diving Championships, Sadie Cota finished in 10th place and Samantha Cota finished in 12th place. 8 other swimmers also competed at the Whippeal Swimming Championships. The boys basketball team qualified for the Whippeal Playoffs, and the varsity ice hockey team competed in the Penguin Cup Playoffs. Our inline hockey team made it all the way to the PIRHL Finals. Congratulations to all of our athletes on a great season. For the 18th year, the Bethel Park High School varsity ice hockey team spent some time at the YMCA skating with Bethel Park special needs students in grades K to 6 to not only form new friendships but also to instill a love of physical fitness in these students. After the skate, everybody enjoyed a pizza lunch together. To thank the hockey players, the younger students made banners to cheer on the team in the Penguin Cup Playoffs. Bethel Park physical education teacher Linda Graney is the driving force behind this annual tradition. A special thanks goes to Jim Liebarger at the Y for the generous donation of ice time and skates. 3 Independence Middle School students, Vincent Taormina, Ashton Newell, and Isaac Usia, arrived at school early every day for 3 months to work on a project to benefit the Bethel Park Historical Society and the Schoolhouse Center Arts Center. If you've driven by the schoolhouse recently, you've noticed that the building is being rehabilitated, including the installation of new windows and classroom refurbishments. Vincent, Ashton, and Isaac used their technical skills on this laser engraver to make 107 dedication nameplates to honor the donors who helped to purchase the new windows in the schoolhouse. In addition to the window nameplates, the students also used the CNC router to make 9 wooden plaques to acknowledge the classroom donors. They are currently wrapping up the third phase of the project, which is the creation of outdoor signage listing the schoolhouse's tenants. All 3 students enjoy working with their hands, and Vincent said it best when he shared, "It makes me feel good to know I did something great for the community." Thanks to all 3 students and to Principal David Minch for coordinating the project with the Historical Society. Neil Armstrong Middle School 6th grade students on Team Odyssey helped Google to pilot its Google Expeditions app in their classrooms. A Google project associate visited NAMS with the Asus Zen phones that the students used to broaden their study of earthquakes and landforms. Students scanned a QR code reader with the phone, and 3D images appeared on their phone so they could get a better understanding of how earthquakes occur, as well as see the differences between landforms such as messes and butts, I think it is. Boots. Okay. Teachers Mike Romito and Dana Polis worked hard to make sure that NAMS was one of 20 area schools selected for this augmented reality pilot that the students kept referring to as very cool. Mr. Romita called the app engaging and said that it helped students to learn in a new way, as it also helped to address the challenges of multiple learning styles. After using the app, the students provided valuable feedback to Google using a Google form that was linked on their Chromebooks. 43 Bethel Park Elementary gifted students converged on Lincoln Elementary School for this year's Gifted Exposition. The theme of this year's expo was inventions, and the students worked very hard to select an invention that inspired their creativity and imagination. Once they selected their invention, they researched the inventor and how the invention had changed over the years. They created a trifold presentation board and shared their findings with the families and friends who attended this event to walk around and learn more about these exciting inventions that have changed our lives. Some of the inventions included high-tech tools such as computers, video game consoles, and drones, while other inventions were designed to help people, such as eyeglasses, Band-Aids, and penicillin. Many students explored food inventions such as popsicles, hamburgers, and potato chips. Coordinating this annual event was Elementary Gifted Coordinator Lisa Yost. Every Lincoln student is publishing a book this year with help from the newly created Lincoln Publishing Center. The Publishing Center is designed to help students to move their creative writing pieces to the final stage of production, which is publishing them with the hope of sharing them with others. By participating in this process, students have the opportunity to improve upon and apply mechanics, usage, and grammar skills, not to mention incorporating some of their weekly robust vocabulary words into their writing. Students are writing stories, research reports, and poems within their classrooms, and once they are edited, the older students type them using Google Docs while the younger students have their work typed for them. The stories are then printed out in book form, sewn on a sewing machine to bind the pages, and then assembled onto pre-made covers that are constructed from cereal boxes and recycled wallpaper samples. Many of the book's covers were made by the residents of the Paramount Senior Living in Bethel Park, who used their recreational time to make the covers. We thank them for making this project truly intergenerational. We also thank Lincoln Instructional Support Teacher Mrs. DiGregorio for creating the special area at the school. Thanks to the generosity of the Washington PTO, the Washington Playground is the beneficiary of new playground equipment. The PTO raised $68,000 for the purchase of the new equipment, which was installed in March, with the ribbon-cutting ceremony held on March 19th to officially open the playground for fun. Thank you, Washington PTO, for making recess more fun than ever. And that concludes our report for this evening.
Thank you very much. Student government.
All right, good evening, ladies and gentlemen of the board and audience. My goodness, it's been a month already. Time is truly flying by this year. Anyway, update from student government. The main thing we're currently doing is planning the events for our annual staff appreciation week going from April the 30th through May 4th. We plan to include a breakfast for the teachers and staff, serving coffee and donuts for the bus drivers at the bus garage, having a snack cart go around the floors of the high school, delivering carnations to the staff, and we also plan to do the annual lunch lady luncheon and teacher lunch, excuse me. Also, I'd like to take the opportunity to acknowledge Dr. Pascarilla. For those of you that don't know, Dr. P, if I may, recently attended our homeroom representatives meeting last month, where he answered multiple questions from students regarding concerns that they have. Personally, I thought it was truly a great thing to have an administrator there at a meeting, and it's something that we're definitely considering doing again in the future. So on behalf of my colleagues of the executive board, Dr. P, I thank you.
Thank you.
You have to bring the tuba and play for us next time. Congratulations. Thanks. PTA PTO Council.
Good evening. My name is Melissa Pulaski. I'm one of the co-presidents at William Penn. All right. Abraham Lincoln Elementary. Abraham Lincoln celebrated World Down Syndrome Day with lots of socks on March 20th. The Lincoln Loggers are getting ready for the Children's Marathon by meeting every Friday during recess to walk together. Lincoln students raised $6,420 for the American Heart Association with the Jump Rope for Heart fundraiser. Registration for the Lincoln Science and Art Fair is currently underway. The fair will be held on April 26th. Applications for the Abraham Lincoln PTO Award for Higher Education are now being accepted through May 1st. The PTO is awarding two scholarships in the amount of $500 each to two former Lincoln students graduating from Bethel Park High School. Ben Franklin. Ben Franklin had a very exciting March. They had a very successful readathon fundraiser. Students clocked in over 75,000 minutes this year. Ben hosted a family fun night this past weekend. They are preparing information for the Ben Franklin PTO scholarship, and they are excited to participate in the Autism Acceptance Month starting April 2nd. George Washington Elementary is extremely excited to report that the playground was finally installed, and on Monday, March 19th, all of the students were able to explore the new playground. They also had a very successful art and science fair with 47 students presenting their science experiments, the string students showing off what they have learned so far, and the parents enjoying artwork from all of their students was presented around the school. The spring book fair was a great success, and each of their students received a free book of a $4.99 value from the PTO. George Washington students are getting ready for the talent show on April 13th, movie night on April 20th, and staff and student appreciation scheduled for the end of April and beginning of May. Memorial Elementary. They just wrapped up their Sarah's Candy fundraiser and have their final spring fundraiser starting next week. They are happy to say that with the funds this year, they are able to purchase replacement swings for some of the swing sets. They had the student store on the 9th, which continues to support the fourth grade activities. They actually have their fourth grade social at the end of this month, which is a fun way to send off the kids from Memorial onto Neil Armstrong Middle School. Their annual talent show took place on the 23rd, and they had an awesome turnout, and the kids had a great night and also had the pleasure of acknowledging Miss Francis that evening. Looking ahead to April, they have a BOGO Spring Book Fair during the first week with an evening family event to shop for books as well. They also have Memorial Movers starting every Tuesday to prepare for Kids Marathon in May. William Penn held its 10th annual calendar party. Over 200 guests attended and over $8,000 was raised for their school. Their spring book fair was held this month and was a big success. The kids enjoyed looking through all of the items and picking out their own books. The success of the book fair helps their library get new titles to add to its collection. The children celebrated Dr. Seuss's birthday by dressing up as their favorite Dr. Seuss character or by wearing red, white, and blue. They are currently holding their spring clothing sale. Through their fundraising this year, the PTO was able to fund transportation for an additional music field trip for the second grade. They are currently working on plans for their ice cream social, which will be held on April 20th. And they have been participating in the Kids of Steel program that is part of the Pittsburgh Marathon in May. The kids stay after school on Thursdays to prepare and condition for their 1 mile marathon that is held the day before the official Pittsburgh Marathon. Neil Armstrong had a busy March. It started out with the yearly Battle of the Books competition, which had 36 teams participating. Then there was a Scholastic Book Fair and a spring spirit wear sale. Last but not least, their second Cosmic Bingo was just held last Friday. Independence Middle School. The IMS PTSO would like to congratulate all the cast, crew, and directors of Beauty and the Beast. Thank you to all the parents, students, and staff who helped make this another successful musical.
Thank you so much. Always so involved. Solicitor's report?
No report tonight, Madam President.
Thank you, sir. Do we have any committee reports? Mrs. Buckley, Mrs.
I was unable to attend, so I do not.
Okay. Good.
Oh, I did attend. Shasta had their school fair. It's the first time they tried it, and it really was successful, and our own Bethel Park had their big data exhibit, so it went over very well. So I imagine we will be doing it again next year, so that's a good thing. The AAU's named an interim director. It's not for publication yet, but at least that process is over for a while. Also, with the school here, the Bunny Brunch, Mrs. Smoller and Mrs. Simpson and the DECA and FCCLA really worked their hearts out for the Bunny Brunch this year. In fact, Mrs. Simpson was still in the kitchen at noontime. But they had over 150 registrants. They had to cut it off. So that was a good thing. I did attend Memorial's talent show, and it really was cute. They just get up there and pour out their hearts, and the tribute to Mrs. Francis was very, very nice. And the last thing I want to say under the Career and Technology Education Center, the Chamber and I are trying to pull together an apprentice program. If any of you know of any students or any young male adults who'll be looking for work as a machinist, we have a company in Bethel that's really expanding. And come next year, they're going to have like 40 jobs immediately. So we're trying to create an apprentice line, and we're willing to get these students trained and get them, they'll be having jobs at the end of their program. So the quicker we can get them in the stream, the better off we'll be. We'll be working with Still Center and probably the Western area, which is located in Cannonsburg, because they right now have classes, but they can't keep the students. They're gone. The jobs are just, they have a job right out of that program. But now we have this company right here in Bethel that will have all these good paying jobs, and we've got to help get it staffed. Right now they have 4 openings. So if you know of anybody, give me a call, let me know. So, but that's the thing, career technology and education, that is the place for the jobs for the next decade. There's going to be a lot of jobs in this whole area available and right here in our own backyard. So let me know if you know of anybody. That's
it. Great, thank you. Public comments on agenda items.
Sharon Janicek, 4314 Anna Street. I wanted to make a comment on the item that was added to the agenda for discussion only, the 420 National School Walkout. I just, before you start discussing it, hope that it's not added to discuss potentially withdrawing the district support to the student movement. I think a lot of students were rather disappointed that they did not get to participate in March. And although some did do something anyway, many students did not feel that they could take a zero for their work and miss class for that. And I hope that we recognize that although we all have our own views of what that movement might mean politically and what it might mean in the future for us, I hope we can recognize that the students have their views as well. And as much as we will have an opportunity to express ours in the coming months as our nation moves forward on these issues, it's a time for them to express that as well. And when we were all here talking about school safety, one of the things we talked about a lot was mental health and social support for our students. And I think too that there are probably many students who might want to participate in that, who might be doing it more for the coming together and the communal sharing of their feelings, of their grief and their anger and their fear. And I think that as a school community, supporting that and having our adults help our students work through those emotions and being there for them is vitally important, regardless of how we view the larger issue. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Then I'm going to move into business items, curriculum committee, and Mrs. Buckley.
Thank you, Mrs. Cook. There are 3 items this evening under curriculum. Would any like any of those held out? Hearing none, I move under curriculum number 1, the Distributive Education Clubs of America, DECA, Change, and Hershey, PA trip, which was ratified. Number 2, the Distributive Education Clubs of America, DECA, Change in Atlanta, Georgia trip. And the last one, the Grand National Forensic League Tournament competition to be held in Washington, D.C., May 25th through the 29th, 2018.
Second.
Items 1 through 3 under Curriculum Committee have been moved by Mrs. Buckley and seconded by Mr. Means. Any questions or comments on any of these items? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Those items carry 9-0. Personnel Committee and Mrs. Rule.
There are 16 items under personnel. Are there any that anyone would like to have held out?
I'd like to have number 2 held out, particularly two items under number 2, under high school athletics, head cheerleading and assistant cheerleading.
Head cheerleading and who and what?
And assistant cheerleading, okay. Under the high school athletics.
Okay.
Those are the only two I want held out.
Any others? Seeing none, I move the approval of extra duty responsibility program. 3, acceptance of resignation. And 4, approval of substitutes. 5, approval of staffing changes. 6, approval of leave of absence. 7, approval of extend leave of absence. 8 is furlough list. 9 is change of assignment. 10 is appointment of personnel. 11 is an individual memorandum of agreement with the Bethel Park Federation of Teachers. 12 is individual memorandum of agreement with the Bethel Park Federation of Teachers. 13, individual memorandum of understanding with the Bethel Park Federation of Secretaries. 14, appointment of personnel 2017-18 alternative education program. 15, transportation clerk increase of hours. And 16, approval of part-time temporary assignment.
Second.
Item 1 and 3 through 16 under Personnel Committee have been moved by Mrs. Rule and seconded by Mrs. Buckley. Any questions or comments on any of these items? All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Those items carry 9-0. Mrs. Rule.
Okay. I move that we approve of extra duty responsibility program.
Item 2 under personnel has been moved by Mrs. Rule and seconded by Mr. Amidits. Any questions or comments on this item?
I think to clarify, this is just for the cheerleading part that was withheld. Everything else was approved on the previous.
Well, we didn't move that. Connie didn't move that.
I didn't move
that.
I
just held it out.
Yeah.
Well, we held it all out, so I think when you vote, you'll have to, I guess, specify that. Particular item, if you want to.
Or they amend it or change it?
Can't we just amend
whatever? Yes.
Can't we?
Sure. I mean, you could amend. I mean, if you're moving now for the approval of 2, someone could move to amend it to pull out the 2 cheerleader positions. Mm-hmm. You could vote on the amendment and then separately vote on the cheerleader positions if you're comfortable doing that.
They can't just vote a no on 2 positions.
You could do it that way too.
I mean, since it's been moved that way, I would.
You should probably do it with an amendment.
That's what I'm going to do. I'll just vote no on those 2 items.
Correct. Any other questions or comments on this item? All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed?
No for those 2 positions.
And that was a no. Mrs. Dobas down here.
Mr. Nagel.
Nagel.
Christensen.
So item 2, other than the head cheerleader and assistant cheerleader at the high school, passes 9-0 on those 2 items. It would be 6-3. Facilities and Services Committee and Mr. Workmeister.
Okay. Okay, Mrs. Cook, I have 2 items under Facilities and Services Committee for approval. One being approval of a donation, and 2 being the change order for the hillside landside at the high school. Would anybody like any of those held out? So I request to have this for approval.
And I need a second.
Second.
Items 1 and 2 under Facilities and Services have been moved by Mr. Workmeister and seconded by Mrs. Dobas. Any questions or comments on either of these items?
This is, on item number 2, the change order for the Hillside landslide. This is the final payment, correct?
Yes.
Yes, that's correct. It is supposed to be the final payment, correct?
Yes.
I just caution that, but this is the final markup. Is that correct, Mr. Solicitor?
Yes, that's correct. The work that R&B was contracted to do has been completed at the site, so this is the last payment.
This would be the one that we're referring to, just to be clear with the public, on IMS, going on the backside of IMS. In other words, we are right now continuing to do boring and testing on the softball field, and we're waiting on information back, just to clarify.
Correct. Good?
Mm-hmm. Correct.
Any other questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Those items carry 9-0. Finance Committee and Mr. Amidits.
And this evening we have 11 items under the Finance Committee, and we have one discussion item that Mr. Perez is going to be updating us on the budget. So for the 11 items, I'm going to move items 1 through 11, number 1 being the March 2018 salaries and bills, number 2 the February 2018 financial report, number 3 budgetary transfers, number 4 adoption of Allegheny Intermediary Unit resolutions, number 5 awarding of E-rate bid, number 6 approval of the purchase of information technology equipment budget, number 7 approval of the purchase of information technology equipment for the 2017-2018 budget, number 8 fundraiser proposal for the Crohn's and Colitis Foundation, number 9 renewing of the food service contract, number 10 acceptance of grant, and number 11 awarding of the photography request for proposal. And I apologize that I didn't ask if anybody wanted any of those held out. I apologize.
Hopefully no one did. Did anyone want anything held out? Okay, you're good to go. I need a second.
Second.
Thank you. Items 1 through 11 under Personnel Committee have been moved by Mr. Amidits and seconded by Mr. Means. Any questions or comments on any of these items? I'd just like to make a comment for the public that we're doing a little differently in our photography than ever I heard of in Bethel Park. We actually are awarding, different companies have come in and different schools have elected to go with different companies this time around. So that's going to be a new and exciting venture, I think, for the families in the different schools. Also re-awarding, I see Mr. Consul Magno here from Nets, rewarding that food service contract. Anything else? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That carries 9-0. Do we want to do that discussion item then on the budget update?
Sure. I have a few slides for draft 7. It continues to be a work in progress. Draft 4 was $797,211 of the fund balance. We made some changes. Draft 7 went up. It's now $1.2 million use of the fund balance. But we still have work to go. Does anybody have any questions on that slide?
I just have a comment, I guess.
Okay, go ahead.
What we've done at this given point is, you know, the additional of some technology dollars that eventually, as we always said, they could end up going over in any given year. So in this year, we're anticipating some overage, and then maybe in future years, we might anticipate it going down. You heard that presentation. In other words, we're going to buy things, and it doesn't always, when we purchase these items, they don't always come in equal amounts. So that is one increase. Also, we talked about the increase of the 10-month school police officers. So those three positions have been added. And with a variety, because we're not sure each position will be negotiated, so Mr. Krasny put a variety of salaries in, a balanced amount of salaries, because it could depend on experience and such as to what somebody may make. And so those are the additions. However, obviously next time when we meet, there will be some, you know, staffing conversation due to some of the retirements, which will most likely bring
that number down some if the board chooses to not replace.
Okay, the changes, salaries went up by $183,750, benefits $127,000, professional service $10,000, property service and other services about $1,400, supplies $13,709, equipment $59,000, and other objects $144,000. Other financing uses went up $20,000. So the total that it went up was $560,259.
Buzzy, out of curiosity, what are other objects? What would that entail?
I'll explain that here in a minute.
Okay.
And does would equipment include equipping the new school resource officers? Or?
No, most of that's in the supply budget. Okay, but there is money. There was extra money budgeted for supplies and training and things like that for the school police officer. The salaries and benefits increased by $311,525. $32,000 of that we'll get back because that's the FICA retirement portion as well. And we added three police officers. Here's the other changes. The professional services increased by $10,049, and that's due to we're required to provide $10,049 to non-public schools. Supplies increased of $13,709. Most of that's due to supplies and uniforms, training for this security department. Equipment increased $59,000. $6,000 was moved from equipment to supplies. $66,000 was added to the IT budget for the firewall, basically, that we're going to be purchasing in the computers. In following years, that could come back down. We don't know. We'll have to wait and see. You never know with technology what you're going to get into. The increase is $144,500 due to expenditures for the pre-K grant that I didn't have in draft four. I missed that. So that's what that was. And the $20,000 and the $900,000, is we added the $20,000 to the capital reserve fund transfer for the TURF. During draft four, we talked about that. It was 80,000. We
increased it.
Great. Most of the other objects, Jim, from your question, is debt service and transfers to other funds. The capital reserve fund, this is the same slide that I gave you last time, except under budget expenditures for 18-19. We added $360,000 for the buses that we are going to purchase. I think three big and two little, two mini buses. So that's, we're budgeting $360,000 for that. That could go up or down, depending on what it's going to be. Okay, the revenue changes. Interest on investments increased by $155,901. I talked about that last budget meeting, and we're doing very well on our investments this year, so I felt good about increasing that. The pre-K counts, based on Beth's finalizing the application, would be $46,750 less than what it was. Social Security and PISA's subsidy increased probably about $32,000 to $33,000 because our expenditures increased, and the federal revenue increased due to the updated program amounts that we expect to get for next year.
Okay, but do you know how many students were down in the pre-K, our pre-K count?
Sure, so we currently offer a half day and a full day program, and they're having problems with the half day. They don't have the space to offer that program moving forward, and this year we apply for the next 5-year cycle, and so instead of only offering 15 full day slots, we're going to offer 17 full day slots, and increase the full day slots, but they do not have the space to offer the half day slots, so that's the decrease.
what next. We'll continue to work on budget drafts, and we'll work on everything that's listed there. And staffing, as Dr. Pastorella mentioned, we'll be working on in the next couple of weeks, and hopefully we can make adjustments on that as well. We still want to plan to adopt a tentative budget in April and the final budget in May. That's our plan.
So on slide one, you had the $1.2 million deficit.
Yes.
Is that deficit due to any significant payments out of the capital fund? You had mentioned, busing. But are there any, major expenditures that we've already planned for?
That doesn't include the capital reserve fund.
It doesn't include any expenses out of the capital reserve fund.
Pardon me, Barry.
The expenditures that you have there, $87 million, that doesn't include any capital expenditures.
That does not.
Okay, that's just operating expenses.
Yes.
Okay.
We don't have any capital reserve expenditures in there. There are some, what we probably call capital expenditures in the IT department, but that's part of the general fund budget.
Right. Okay.
You'd be asking them to vote on the preliminary budget.
We'll have a voting meeting at the committee meeting in April, the first meeting in April.
And to be clear for the public, though, even though you adopt that then, there could still be changes between them.
There will be changes, no doubt.
I know.
Any other questions for Mr. Carrazzi? Thank you, sir. Policy Committee and Mr. Means.
Mrs. Cook, I'd like to take care of item number one and take the vote on that before we enter into the discussion.
Sounds good.
Okay. Item number one, approval of policy revision, third and final reading for 808 food services and 808.1 school lunch / breakfast program charge meals. Anybody want to say anything about this? Okay, I move that item number one, the third and final reading of those two policies be approved.
Second.
Who seconded, Mrs. Rule?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Item one under policy committee has been moved by Mr. Means and seconded by Mrs. Rule. Any questions or comments on this item? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That item carries 9-0. And we have a discussion item, which a few board members requested that be placed on there regarding that April 20th National School Walkout, which, as a reminder, was in essence delayed from the March original planned walkout, which I guess was then attended by about 100 students. But was not the planned endeavor that they had presented to us prior to the March date.
Yeah. So, Mrs. Cook, I've become increasingly concerned about this. As the movement has grown from the days of the initial shooting, it's become more and more politicized. And I think it's taken on a definite political aspect. As a matter of fact, I would say it's probably the most political movement in the country right now. It has taken on anti-gun, anti-NRA. It's taken on, in certain respects, anti-Republican, anti-conservative. It's taken on a pro-choice and aspect to it. And I think it's a violation of our policy for the school to be getting into anything political like this. Now, before you get upset about something like that, I'd like to caution people that there's a movement right now that some people, I think Glenn Beck's behind it, wants to start a national walkout for the right to life. So if we open up our school and start sponsoring walkouts and letting people walk out during the school in those types of things, we're going to have to be unbiased and allow all sorts of different types of walkouts. So I think it is really unadvisable for us to become involved in a political movement like this.
Even on this topic in particular, if you can imagine that, consider this as, you know, if it's becoming a political issue. The other alternative, the mirror image of the political statement here would be to do something like arm teachers, for instance. So if there was a student movement to arm teachers, would we support that initiative as well? You know, so it opens up the door where, forget about this issue in particular, that, you know, if we are going to support an initiative like this, we have to be open-minded to support almost any initiative that comes to us.
Also, I was going to say, also, what we're looking at is a situation here where, first, it started off where it was, and we all have great pain and sorrow for what happened, not only in Parkland, but in any school, and for that matter, any area where lives have been lost due to senseless acts, people that are either mentally ill or whatever the reasons are. So also, we all support the First Amendment rights of kids to be able to, or anybody, not just kids, to be able to take a stand and, do some kind of, I don't want to call it protest, but to go do a march or whatever it is. But as a school board member for myself, we have a lot of issues here. First, it was supposedly not going to be a gun rights type thing, is what it was told. But Post-Gazette, the PSBA, there's a ton of, worthy news articles out there saying exactly what it is, and it's saying that if you read it, I have links if you want, that spell it out that it is a gun rights issue and a lot of other things. And we as a district, we have to stay neutral on things, especially sensitive issues like that. It's a Second Amendment right and everything else. Also, we have the issue of safety. We are going to go and let these kids out, or we even say we don't, do we now have to get security guards and everything else? And you think, well, this is a peaceful, there's a lot of school districts that had it where it was very peaceful, and probably they didn't even have the agenda of the gun rights. They just wanted to feel, you know, honor those 17 kids with their 17 minutes. Now, we did have a little one already. I know that some people missed out and all that, but just to say we did already show some acknowledgement. But if you look right now at some of the schools in California, there was big uprisings there. It's all publicized. We can go and show you links on that. So this stuff could get out of hand. Do I think Bethel Park would? No. I think we have, you know, very sensible kids and everything else. But again, we have that responsibility of not only trying to stay neutral and everything else, but we've got the safety of the kids involved here as well. So I could go on, but you know, I just want to give at least some of my points here for now. So,
all right. Well, I'm in favor of going forward with the plan with the makeup day. I'm in support of our students who choose to take a stand against the inaction of political leaders on the issues of school mass shootings. For most of these young men and women, their entire lives have been under the threat of attack in their schools. They have been forced to spend valuable classroom time training on what to do if such an attack were to occur. They're saying this is unacceptable, and I agree. I'm not only proud that our students have decided to take a stand against the paralysis of our leaders, but that they showed the maturity to engage our administration just so that they could do it in a proactive, productive way. This isn't just any demonstration, any protest. This is a momentous time in their young lives. Whether we approve or not, they're going to learn from this. They'll learn the lessons of civic engagement and leadership. They'll also learn who stands with them in moving forward to solve these problems and who is satisfied with the status quo. I've heard many people make this demonstration solely about gun control. I've heard a few of you tonight. While there's a voice for stricter gun laws, some are also calling for more social workers, better mental health screening, more SROs, as we approved tonight, early intervention with some of these students, metal detectors, and many other ways to minimize threats. In all, it's a call to do something. We're approaching the 19th anniversary of the Columbine Massacre, and very little, if any, substantial action has been taken on a state and federal levels. Instead, time and time again after these tragedies, thoughts and prayers are offered and very little is done. While I place a lot of value on thoughts and prayers, I pray every night and often throughout the day, may mean very little without actions and deeds. Some may want to make this about guns to excite their political base. While guns are a part of the conversation, make no mistake, this is not about your guns. This is about your kids. I'll close with a proposal. We support the students who want to participate. We treat it as a field trip. We ask the students to write an essay or a letter to their legislators to explain why they were demonstrating and what they would like to see. As for treating their generation's actions as an affront to our values, how about we realize that our generation's inaction is a threat to their lives? And let me just touch on the whole political aspect of this. When this was first brought up, I heard very little opposition from the board. I didn't start hearing opposition from the board until I got an email that was forwarded from the chairman of the Republican committee. I don't take my marching orders from the Democratic committee, the Republican committee, any committee. If we're trying to politicize this and make it about gun issues in order to enrage our base or excite our base, then shame on us. This has been going on. I was closer to these kids' age than I am to many at your age now when Columbine happened, and really nothing's happened since then. These kids are basically saying, enough, let's do something. And I support them in that. I support them being civically engaged. I think there's a lot of lessons to be learned from this, and I'll stand by going forward with the 420.
Mr. Nagel, your whole speech confirms my assertion that this is a political event. You said right off.
Everything's a political event.
Which is
everything
why.
In society is a political.
Which
event.
Is why this should not be conducted on school. It's against our policies. We
it's
have policies.
It's against our policy for employees to engage in political
yes.
events, not students.
And employees
students
are engaged
engage
in it.
To employees, the employees are just providing them safe space.
I think we should take a step back for a minute. When it originally occurred, it was as a memorial to the students. To the students who died. They read the names of the students. It was 17 minutes of a memorial. Unfortunately, the decision was made to cancel that memorial because of weather. And we gave another date, not we, another date was given to do the makeup for it. The fact that between the first date and the second date, there are all of these politicized things has nothing to do with what the students want to do. The students are going to walk out on that date, regardless of the consequences, because we allowed it. We told them they could do it. And then we canceled it because of It was canceled because of poor weather. So it's a planned event for 17 minutes for them to read the names of the students. Think of it from the students' point of view. Not all students are going to walk out. Not all students are going to participate. But those that have already signed up have a right to do what they were going to do a month ago, and we can't go back on our word that all of a sudden, because it's a political event, you can't do it. Because it's not. It's a memorial. It's a reading of the names of the students who died. And then they go back into the classroom. There are no speeches going to be given. It's a reading of 17 of the names of the students who died. We said we were going to allow it to happen. We said it was a civics lesson for the students to express themselves. The weather was inclement. We canceled it and said there's another date. There's another date.
Mrs. Frazier, can I just ask you to reiterate for us the plan that was proposed and what I assume would still be the plan moving forward? between the students and the administration, correct?
Of course. Good evening, everyone. Hello, ladies and gentlemen of the board, and community members. I'm here today to elaborate on all of this, and I think it's valuable to hear all of your perspectives and community members to speak on this. And I think where this really began was right after the Parkland incident, that students approached Dr. Janzanski and myself. School leaders, student leaders came to us and said that they wanted to express the solidarity from Bethel Park High School, come together and show that they stand together through all of this, they support one another. And I think this incident is different from the others because of the voice that students have had with this, the empowerment through all the means of social media that have been kind of in the palms of their hands. If you follow the news, you see that those students are really blazing the way of saying, changes that they want to make. So our students have taken that, and they also want to have a voice in this. So when they approached Dr. Janzanski and myself about this, they had orchestrated this whole idea. So our involvement was really minimal. It was just about making sure that we kept it safe with gathering the Bethel Park police, so our partnership with them, and then making sure that our faculty was in a position that we could be aware of all of the students and their movement, make sure we knew which doors they were going to go out. And this was all presented from the students. None of this was thought of by Dr. Janzanski or myself. We just wanted to hear them. And I think it's very mature of them that they want to take a stand and they've come up with this. But I think you are correct with saying there has been a lot that has unfolded since, that time that we sat down with the staff, because a lot of those school walkouts did occur. We had frigid weather. We did cancel it because of the weather. It was frigid. And we did have students that still decided to go outside, and they shivered their way through that 17 minutes. But to see those students announce all of those names was powerful. I think that they all kind of took that, and we'll never forget that moment, because it really showed how that they have, in their generations, lean on each other, because they will be the ones that set the bar for the rest of their lives and the next generation that graduates from high school. So not to have
So then you do, you don't know if they are still going to do just what you outlined to us in the meeting in March. Right. They may be changing what they... since you delayed the event.
Mrs. Frazier, this is, there's a fake facade on this whole thing that this is completely student-led and nonpartisan. But the very day after the Parkland shooting, Debbie Wasserman Schultz, the chairman of the Democratic National Committee, was down there to try and organize people. The Women's March was down there. They have a youth arm of it, and they were using their resources to organize it. Planned Parenthood has been helping to train people, and the American Federation of Teachers has been involved. This has not been a student-led thing. It has been political from the very beginning. It's just surfaced over the last, well, the longer it goes on, the more it becomes apparent it's political. When you announced it, that was going to happen. You took me back by surprise, and I wasn't prepared to argue against it. But so much has come out now, and it's political. I think we should abandon it. We already had one walkout. Now we're talking about a second walkout. And what are you going to do when the students come to you and they say, we want to walk out for humane treatment of animals? We want to walk out in support of the pro-life position? Allowing students to schedule these walkouts, allowing them to dictate it, is not the way things should be done. And I realize they have First Amendment rights, but they don't have a First Amendment right to disrupt the educational process. We've already been up against the stops trying to get our 990 hours in for the year. We had one disruption already. It's not a 17-minute disruption. You have to pull people out of class, send them down there, have them assemble, the 17 minutes of silence, bring everybody back. You're talking about disrupting one, if not two, classes. And we already did that once. And I think it sets a bad precedent. And if we do this for this, we're going to have to be open to allowing protest and walkouts for other movements. Can I ask you a question? If a kid came to school and he had a picture of an M16 or AR-15 on his shirt, would that be acceptable under the school code? No. So we can have an anti-gun protest, but if a kid comes with a picture of a gun on his shirt, he would be sent home or told to put something on over it, correct? Okay.
Ms. Scott.
Yes, sir.
I'm going to... Excuse me. I've heard fellow board members there, but I appreciate everybody's opinion. I'm going to be in favor of continuing with the support of the students in this particular event. When they proposed it last month, they said what they intended to do, and I was in favor of it, and I still am. I just want to go back to earlier in the meeting. Under the Finance Committee, we had a fundraiser proposal for the Crohn's and Colitis Foundation. Now, this is just one small example, in my opinion, of what we as a board do all the time. We allow our students to become involved in different community and civic involvement. There are some people that may feel that the government should, for example, fund everything that has to do with health care. But we don't get involved in that. And the way I look at it is that it's one of the best lessons for our students is to get involved civically in our community, in our country, and sometimes in the world. We've had international involvements with them. So I will continue to do that. I will go along with that. We talked about STEAM, science, technology, education, and engineering and mathematics. That's very important. We forget the other part of it, our civic involvement again. This is an opportunity for them to get involved in it. Doesn't matter what my opinion is. I'm not saying what my opinion is. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what any of our board members' opinions are here. I feel that it is incumbent upon us as educational leaders to let our students continue with this and get involved. We encourage them to get involved, and this is another way for me to continue to do that.
Mrs. Cook, if I may.
Yes, Mrs. Cook.
Mrs. Frazier, if you could give us a little bit of clarification. You gave us a lot of information at the last meeting, which I truly appreciated, as far as the police department's involvement for this particular activity. Thank you.
So we heard the idea, and then we partnered with Detective Joel Dixon as the school resource officer. So gave her the information of
Thank you. Okay. As far as the discussion tonight, I'm glad this discussion is taking place. I think this is very healthy. For me personally, I will continue to support the students as far as the decision that we made last month in having the walk. I'm sorry it was canceled. I wish that had never occurred, but that's neither here nor there. But for me personally, and I've said this, and it's nothing new, I don't have an R or a D after my name. It doesn't have anything to do with being Republican or Democrat. We are here because of children. And we are representing the children, in my opinion, in this cause. And some people may accuse me of being naive, and so be it. But I think under this, and the fact that I respect what Mrs. Frazier has shared, the work that has gone in, and our students involved in it, I think that we need to do what we said we were going to do and proceed from there. Thank you.
Mrs. Cook? I do agree that we should go forward with it because our students came to us, and they came to us with a plan. And I think those were good indicators. You did address my concern. I was very concerned about external forces coming because, you know, Channel 11 and those will be here. And I was concerned about outside forces coming, not our students, but, you know, outside. So I'm glad that you addressed that for me.
End of conversation.
Right. That was my concern. Okay.
You know, these kinds of issues are always tough. I recall having a phone conversation with Nancy Rose, our previous superintendent, who called me to say, well, the president of our country at the time is going to give a speech to school children. Are we permitted to show that? Why are you calling me? I couldn't even, like, that didn't even, what? Are we permitted? Well, it's the president of our country. Yeah, I just, again, I believe the presentation that was made, that the students came to us. They could have just walked out. I saw in a number of school districts that they didn't have necessary plans. They just walked out. Okay, that's number one. It could and probably would in some capacity happen and would happen anyway. I think it was very mature of our student leaders to come and work with our administrators to formulate a plan and something that we could all feel was safe to do, that was giving a voice to our students to do. I loved their ideas, the releasing the balloons. I'm hoping that they'll still go with some of those initial plans. I did read a number of the articles. I think it's more adults who got on the bandwagon in these various organizations and politicized it and brought in the guns and brought in, you know, some of these other things. I don't think the students initially started out with that. It was that camaraderie. It was that, I think that it can be for gun safety and against gun violence, it doesn't need to be about gun control. I think that was a message that I saw in a number of the schools that said, you know, they supported the right to bear arms in many of the schools, but safety was their whole message, if there was anything. But I look at it as almost an assembly-like program. We provide assemblies to our students at all times all through the year, and I can't say that I, as a board member, know what every single assembly program is about. I feel, again, I have an overarching duty, but I'm not there in the day-to-day operations of the school. And I think our administration has made this a safe event, has planned to make this a safe event, has worked with our students in comprising something that can be done that isn't political in nature, that isn't touching upon some of these issues. And I think since we delayed it, I just can't see not supporting our students moving forward when we told them that the choice was to either have it that day or the other day. We called this the rain date or the weather date anyway. Are they still going to have the fundraiser, the thon thing on the Saturday following this as well? Right, and again, what would, if you were going to have a penalty for that, right? That's what I also don't know. Another option, too, if that is an inclement weather day, like if it's storming or something, I think some of the districts I read had in-house, inside activities, like in the auditorium or the gymnasium or something like that. Dr. Pasquarello, do you want to weigh in on this issue at all?
You're allowed to say
no. And you don't
no.
have to if you don't want to.
Well, I mean, to be honest with you, not to lighten the mood, but often, you know, I watch the news when the weather is bad, and so I was hoping that since the weather's better, I haven't watched it quite as much as I normally do. But I do honestly believe, just from, and this is all gut, which I use a lot in my days to make decisions, and that sometimes is popular in addition to data, and sometimes it's not. But in meeting with the homeroom kids, they just seemed to be very honest, as the young man said today. So, I mean, I wasn't in the meeting where they came to the staff, but what was originally told to me, anyway, this is what I can tell you, from the administrator, so I didn't hear it firsthand, was that I didn't hear anything about that. I heard that this was going to be a moment of silence for lost lives. That's what I had heard that the students portrayed to the administration. Not, you know, being activists on either side of these issues, and these issues I do think rolled out. You know, there was a decision made at some point there at the high school due to the weather, and you know, in hindsight, if I could have gotten to them a little quicker and we could have had more discussion, I would have told them maybe we should have an option where we did it inside. That probably would have been my recommendation. But you know what? You know, the decision was made. It was kind of approved, and they went with that, and that's what happened. So I guess when I weigh in on it, I think like this. We do a lot of things, and a lot of you know, it was mentioned about animals or these types of things, and we do approve, and I always kind of run those through the school board through the email to say we do a coin drive or somebody does a project or those kind of things, and we kind of let students do that. Now I would agree that we don't want this to become, although as a former government teacher, it's important to understand your rights and involvement in government, and I think that's important so that you understand that. It is not our job to try to guide you in one side or the other. That's not what the school district, myself as a superintendent, teacher, staff, or anyone else is to do. Our job is to help you think and create and learn and be innovators and understand government and then make your own mind up, and maybe your mind changes, right? I mean, but to me, I never heard that from the start. So, I mean, if you're asking for my recommendation, I would check to make sure that that is still accurate, that that's what the students were looking to do. And if the way by which they were going to demonstrate originally was something that now is viewed as one side or the other, and in fact, really their goal was just to do what they originally said, then maybe it needs to be slightly tweaked and more about the loss of lives rather than the issue. So as far as I'm concerned as the superintendent, sure. I try to remain neutral, and in my own mind, I think you guys have known this. I mean, I'm not on one side or the other. I'm on Joe Pasquarello's side, and that's often unpopular. But I make my own mind up, right? So I guess my point to you is I'm not making this statement to sway one way or the other. And or to have that opinion. My opinion is, though, that I do believe the children in my gut, that they came to their administration due to loss of life. If that is still the case, and it's not on an issue on one side or the other, but just to recognize loss of life, then I think we need to make sure we're not, and you explain that to them, and we explain the fact, Mrs. Frazier, to the government body that now it might be viewed, our original plan might be viewed on one side or the other, and that's not the district policy, and that wasn't your original intention. Let's figure out something that remains neutral. Then I think that's something that we need to do. And to the point of, could this happen every single day? Well, if it became to the point where something happened every single day, one, it couldn't be political. I agree with you on that. And secondly, we'd have to say, all right, we're going to have to come up with different ways to do this because we can't miss school every day. What other options are there? Mm-hmm. And brainstorming with them might help. From my experience working with the homeroom group, I think they're going to come up with some reasonable ideas. And if they're working with administration, they'll give them some parameters and it should work. But I do agree we don't want to become political. I don't think that was the intention. I didn't hear it firsthand, but when it was brought to me, I heard nothing of it. So I admit that as it progressed and you sent some links, there's some things that have some concerns as it could be viewed one way or the other. But I think we should just really make sure send Mrs. Frazier back to meet with the student government and the student body and make sure their intention is still what it was to start with. And if it is, then I think, in my opinion, we tweak as necessary to the best of our ability to make it that. And if it isn't, then we would have to revisit on, you know, where are the appropriate times and places to do that. And that might not necessarily be in the school setting. That's what I would say.
I would like to make one point of clarification as far as political versus partisan. I do believe that this whole part of the intent of this was to honor those lost. But part of the intent was also to stand against inaction, which by nature, standing for or against anything can be viewed as political. I'm not advocating, nor through my speech did I advocate any policy or any position. I don't want it to turn into something advocating one position or another. What I want to make sure of is that they have a voice as individuals to advocate for change. So when we talk about political, by nature it's going to be political if they're standing for or standing against inaction.
That just wasn't what was, I guess my only final comment on that would be, that wasn't what I heard that was brought up to the administration to me. It was just...
Well, hashtag never again.
I understand you're saying that now, and I learned a lot from that, which I admit. Originally, when you're saying that now, that was brought, the original thought as they progressed through the plan was that our students want to honor the victims' lives. That's what I was told.
That there would be no violence against
right.
Yeah. 17
lives.
Right.
So to your point, I'm not arguing that. I'm just saying what my understanding was. So that's where I stand. I think we do need to remain neutral, but we also need to be sure that in some cases, if it is something that can be done, that we do that. And if it progressed one way or another, I don't believe that was the intention of the kids at all. I don't believe that, students. And it surely wasn't any of our intentions to get to this point. So that's the best statement I could offer. Whatever you decide to do, then we'll adhere to your guidance.
Okay, I'd like to add one comment since Ken talked about the politicizing part like that. The inaction, if we look back in history, having guns in schools, guns in schools used to be allowed. Then it became where no guns in schools, and we've had a lot of arguments about even police officers with a gun in the school. But if you look at what's happened now, because of some of the previous catastrophes before Parkland and that, we do have a lot more guns coming into schools where police officers are allowed. And look at our school here as an example, and look at Maryland as an example. There was another catastrophe there that was ready to brew, but thank God that there was a person with a gun, which was a resource,
officer.
A police officer. Yes. Right. Yes, I was going to say that. There's a resource officer is what it was. I don't know if that's a police officer, but it's a resource officer. They were able to stop the mass killing. Regretfully, there was people shot, but still, the fact is that, and there's not a total inaction. Now the media, has they've been focusing on the gun, and if you watch news tonight, I would bet you money that if you see anything about never again hashtag, it's going to be related to politicized of the anti-gun. Now, I had a lot of people talk to me, and they were concerned about the fact of how Bethel Park's going to be viewed across the world, or at least the nation, with our position on gun control and all this other stuff. What I'm hearing here today is excellent. I mean, we got school safety, my concern about that, being non-politicized, the young adults. They have, when you're old like me, you know, they're all children, right? But the young adults have planned it, and it sounded like they were gonna do like I was expecting, like I said in the beginning of my speech here, that I planned, I think that Bethel Park's gonna go about this the right way and all that. But I did have these concerns. But we don't want to see precedents being set where, like Dr. Pasquarella said, that we don't want people just walking out willy-nilly, because then we do have safety concerns and everything else. And I don't want to go over all the issues, but right now, I mean, I'm happy with the fact that we are addressing this the proper way. It's not just a, yeah, go ahead, do it, and everything, because, I mean, we all want to memorialize these kids, you know. And
you missed the meeting where Mrs. Frazier, you were in Aruba when Mrs. Frazier
Yeah, I was in Aruba. Yeah, thanks. I'm sorry I was gone almost half a month here, so I missed a lot of meetings, regretfully, but I was down in Aruba. I couldn't miss, yeah.
But so. They did present, I thought, a very nice plan that the students had come up with, and I said, I'm hopeful that when you come back that will be very similar, like Dr. Pasquarella said, maybe a little tweak, but hopefully very similar.
I think
to
we
what
would need
plan
some
was,
I just think when you go whichever way you go on this or whatever you're going to tell us, I think we need just some basic guidelines so that when we report back to the students, we know. I mean, obviously we have representation here who's going to go back, but from the administration's point of view, what are our guidelines on that? So, I mean, I guess it's not going to happen, and there's going to be discipline. It is going to happen as planned with no discipline, or maybe a median in the middle somewhere where we just simply say, well, it needs to be tweaked to make sure it just sticks to the original goal. And whatever you say is what we would go back. Now, that doesn't mean it's going to be necessarily as well received or not well received by the students. I cannot answer that. But I think we need clear direction to make sure that we adhere to what the board of directors wants us to do. And we know that moving forward.
I believe it was the consensus, as I heard from my fellow board members, that we would support it moving forward. However, I would say, at least for myself, I was under the impression of what I heard presented to us in the safety meeting as to the intent and the actual carrying out of what they had planned to do. I mean, that I didn't think that was politicized in any way, and I again felt like it was more of a memorial and a coming together of students in support of each other.
But
I
maybe
guess.
We, maybe we didn't talk about what they're really asking for, though. I mean, what they're really asking for is excused absence, right, to conduct this. I mean, that's the ask, right?
Well, I don't think, no. I think they wanted it to be done safely, so we're providing the police to be there. I think they were giving us a breakage of exactly what they were going to do. I mean, quite frankly, they're not just going to go out there massively and just do willy-nilly. I believe that you know, or will know, once you tweak it or meet with them again, exactly what their plans are for that X amount of minutes that it will take to conduct, right? I think that it was a coming together and a plan was given, not just to say we're just going to release you for X amount of minutes from your class to go do this, but that we are with you every step of, we know what is going to happen, I guess, that we...
And we were informed, if I'm correct, that they were going to take the role and make sure none of the kids skipped out after that, and that was...
And another part of it being that students had the option to opt out, or, I mean, they didn't have to participate. Everyone was participating. There would be another study hall or a library period or something for the students
I think it should be an opt-in, not an opt-out.
A tough one. We opt out. We have elementary children who opt out of going to the Halloween parties.
Well,
I don't know how you opt in, opt out.
If it's an opt out rather than an opt in, then it connotates that you're supposed to go.
So you mean the student would sign up to go?
Yes.
Can that be accomplished? Is there some way to accomplish a sign up to go?
There's a way to do it.
Lunch. Right, lunch. Maybe you could put it out in lunch. If you decide to do it, I'm saying you put it out in lunch periods, and people could sign up. Right? Or in the office.
Do you have a sense of what percentage of the school would want to participate? Any sense of?
A big majority.
So opting in might be logistically a little more difficult than opting out if there's a smaller percentage.
I'm glad that you mentioned that it wasn't a mandatory event at all. But the whole piece of having that accountability was so when we go outside, that students, you know, the staff knows where those students are, and they're to meet up with their homeroom teachers and take attendance during that time. So that's another layer of safety. So that's
correct. Does anyone have anything else to add? Do you think I summarized it appropriately?
What decisions have to be made by when?
Well, do we have a, I mean, the only downside is to waiting if you decided to think on it to the next time we meet. There would be a meeting before then, but then it would only be a couple days to make any tweaks, correct? I mean, we would want to notify folks and remind them about the, I mean, because our next meeting is the what,
17th.
So I mean, that's the only downside of waiting to make the decision till then, would be just that if there were any changes or logistics to get that out, that wouldn't be a whole lot of time. Not impossible, but that would be the only downside.
I mean, if is this something that the board has to make a decision on, or is it going to happen anyway? And maybe that's the definition of activism. You know,
going to happen anyway.
Yeah,
it's
okay.
Whether or not you're penalized or whether we are allowing them to be part of it.
If they do it anyway, the ask is, are they going to be excused, right?
Right. Grades and then punishment,
yeah.
I guess. But I think we should still, let me just say this, if it's going to happen anyway, I would say that I would be nervous to not have a contingency plan to keep everyone safe, though. I mean, I understand what you're saying. If we don't acknowledge it, I think we still need to be meeting.
I think we've given the direction that we will move forward with it in some capacity. I believe that was the, I heard that from the board table majority.
Yeah, I don't think we're going to modify the description or the activities here at the board. I think there's a majority.
And I think it would just be to hear a final tweaking, maybe on the April 17th meeting, that we can hear the final tweaking to make sure that it is still along these lines of what was presented to us.
Barring any school closings for snow, we're still good with the hours, at right?
Well, I hope we don't have snow in April, end of April.
But the hours count.
The hours would count. They're still in school. It's an activity.
They still count. Okay.
There will still be discussion, I imagine, in the democracy class or the history. You know, I mean, I believe it will be used as a learning tool experience as well. All right. I need.
So to end on that, then we're going to have her continue as she did and meet with the students for any final plans and come back on the 17th one more time.
Yeah.
We'll add that, folks, to the agenda one more time to make sure that you just give the final overview.
Yep.
Thank you, Mrs. Frazier, for attending another late night. Appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Mr. Amidits, will you take other for me this evening?
We have, I'm going to move all the items under other as including the items that were added in the beginning of the meeting. Would anybody want to be please held up?
Do I have to hold up four for me?
No, you can vote for yourself.
I can vote for
yes, you can.
Is
Hearing none, I move all the items under other.
I need a second.
Second.
Items 1 through 5 under other have been moved by Mr. Amenitz and seconded by Mrs. Buckley. Any questions or comments on any of these items? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Those items carry 9-0. We are now to the point of public comments on anything.
Don't we have to vote on that resolution, Senate Bill 2?
That was number 5. Yeah, that was five. Honey added it. Yeah, we added it. We are to the point of public comments on anything you wish to address the board on. I need name and address at the microphone, and you have 2 minutes for your...
Sharon Janicek, 4314 Anna Street. I'm just going to leave all that alone. Because you were talking about the SRO training, I did want to point out something that we talked about a little bit when we were doing the school safety. I talked about being very mindful of the criminalization of behaviors of students with disabilities. And as we move towards the SROs in our schools more than we currently have, it's becoming more and more real. And since you were discussing the training for those officers, please, please consider training them in how to recognize students who are in emotional distress, how to recognize and deal with students who have disabilities and may not be behaving in a way that the SRO understands, how to de-escalate situations, how to work with those students and those teachers. We can't move to a place where students with disabilities who are having difficulties in their classrooms and not getting the proper support. If you had a behavior specialist, an inclusion specialist, this would help too. I just worry I don't want to end up where those kids are ending up in the juvenile justice system because they aren't getting the support we need to give them. So I just ask that you please be mindful of that. And I know Mrs. Sutton and I have talked about some resources and training for those types of things. So please keep that in mind too. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else? Would any board members wish to make any comments this evening?
I just have a few. I'll make it quick due to the lateness of the hour.
Thank you.
I'm sorry this is a little behind schedule, but I was also out of the country and missed last month's meeting. I wanted to thank all the folks who were involved. This was already mentioned last month about the great Alumni Hall of Fame that was held on February 9th. It was a wonderful event, and I was happy to be there.
Sure.
You can have it. Also attended on March 20th the National Merit Recognition Lunch, and that was addressed too, and it was a very nice afternoon. Mrs. Rule mentioned the bunny brunch for those of us who are now grandparents and parents as well. If you haven't attended this, please mark it on your calendar for next year. The kids involved, as far as the students and the adult advisors, worked very, very hard to put this off, and we enjoyed it very much. And then the last thing, being our representative at the Pathfinder School, for those of you who don't know this yet, and Mrs. Flota has been wonderful in sharing this information, the annual Special Needs Fair and Expo, which we have had in the past over at Pathfinder School, will be taking place on Saturday, April the 28th from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. at the Pathfinder School. It's an opportunity for parents and children to attend and see all the many fine things that are offered for our students, as well as activities for them to be involved with that day, meet some of the folks who work at the Pathfinder School, and if you can fit any of this into your busy schedules, please do, because it is time well spent. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Yeah, I'd like to thank Dr. Pastorella, Mrs. Frazier, and the rest of the staff. I put out a thing about a youth achievement dinner for the American Legion, and it looks like they identified enough students that we have record support coming from Bethel Park. This is put on by the Allegheny County American Legion to honor student achievement in different areas, including scouting, academics, and other extracurricular things. I can't remember if it's 7 or 9 students that we have that are not only have been selected to be honored, but are in the running for a $5,000 scholarship. So thank you guys for getting that out there for us.
Great. I need a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Good night, everyone.